Okay, yeah. So the question is, can you explain the difference between an iterable and an iterator? An iterator is something that actually tracks where you are in some
Yeah.
sequence. And the only thing you can do with an iterator is call next on it. So it's sort of a primitive thing. Like you can't do much with it at all, except get the next item. But what's nice about it is that it keeps track of where you are. Even if you pass it around or give it a different name, I build this iterator out of 1, 2, 3, and then I say u equals t, and I get the next on t, and then I pass u into a function or whatever, and then later on I get next on u, and it's still going to walk me through. So it remembers where I am in the sequence and gives me the next item. So a curious property of iterators is that if you call iter on the iterator, you get back another iterator. Why is this? This seems like a weird thing, but it's sort of a quirk of Python in particular that says, look, if you already have an iterator and what you want is an iterator, then we'll just give you back what you have. So iter t is actually just t again. And what's nice about that is it means that in any situation where you want an iterator and you're not quite sure what you've gotten, because like something got passed in from elsewhere, you can just call iter on it, and then you have an iterator, even though you might have had one already. So yeah, if you have two different things, A is 1, 2, 3, and B is an iterator over 3, 4, 5, and I want to write one piece of code that works for both, well, if I call iter on A or I call iter on B, I'm going to get the same kind of thing, even though they started out as different. And this is kind of how for statements work. So for x in b, print x is going to work just fine. It's going to go through all the values. And for x in a, print x is going to work just fine. It's going to go through all the values. Because in both cases, Python did what it needed to do to get an iterator. For a, it actually had to do some work, construct one. For b, it didn't have to really do any work. It already had an iterator, but it effectively calls iter on it anyway, just to make sure it's an iterator, and then goes through all the elements in it. Yeah, a good way to think about how for in works is that it calls iter on this thing, then goes through all the elements in that iterator that resulted. And I mean, the consequences, even though they both printed them out, the consequences are different in that A, which was never an iterator in the first place, still has all of its elements in it. But B, which was an iterator, is now exhausted, has nothing left in it. And yes, it is accurate that inside this for statement, there was an iterator, which never got a name, that was started out full and was eventually exhausted. And that all kind of happened as an internal process within the for statement. And now it's done, right? That's exactly what happens within Python. And the story here is a little bit different. Instead of creating some new iterator, it just used B itself, because that's what you get when you call iter on B. And so that's why B's iter the iterator got exhausted. Yeah, great question. So how do you go from an iterator back to a list or something that won't get used up? The answer there is that you're building something new. So if I had an iterator, I can only ever go through B once. That's just a fact. One thing I can do while I'm going through B is store all its values in something that's more permanent. When I write list B, what I'm doing is constructing some new list which has all the elements in B. As a result, B is now empty, but C has all the stuff that was in it. Because as I went through B, the one time I was allowed to go through it, I stored all the results in a list and I gave that list an A. Yeah, great question. So, is there anything else you can do with an iterator besides just call next on it? No. I mean, it's an object, so you can do things like pass it in as an argument to some other function or give it a name or something like that. But none of those do anything to it at all. They're just part of the programming environment that you're in. In terms of what you can actually get this iterator to do, the only thing you can do is call next on it. You can't go backwards. You can't peek at it to see what would come next. You can't check if it's about to end. You just call next and that's it. And
Very cool.
uniformly true of all programming languages. So there's always an iterator construct in some programming language, not always, but in most modern programming languages there is. But some of them have additional features. You know, you can check and see if you're at the end of them or something like that. But in Python, really, it's just you call next and that's all. Some people would say there is one more thing you can do, which is you can call iter on it, which is true. But as we saw, like all you do is just get it back. It's not like you're really doing anything at all. That's just sort of a convenience so that anywhere inside of a Python program, if you have something that might be iterable or might be an iterator, you can just call iter on it. And then you know you have an iterator and then you can call next on it. Yeah, great. So the question is about this extra problem or optional problem on the homework question 9, which is a data abstraction problem. And it says, oh, here's some code, which is supposed to basically do the right thing in terms of the arithmetic, but it has some data abstraction violations. What does that mean? The idea here is that you don't know what X and Y are in terms of Python values. You know that they were constructed using the interval function. And so now you know what they are. Like you look at the code and you're like, oh, they're a list. But the whole story of data abstraction is that it's supposed to be the case that this could change, this particular line, which forms the data representation, and your code would still work. But that's not really true. Like if I change this to a dictionary, then this wouldn't work anymore because this piece of code is expecting X to be a list. And in fact, if I change this so it's not a list anymore, then you know I'd get an error. Or if I change this to be a function instead. So how do you write code that will still work even if you change this line? That's what data abstraction is all about. And the story is that you never assume that X and Y are a particular kind of value. Instead, you just assume that X and Y are the kinds of things that you can pass in to the selectors. So really all you're constraining yourself in the way that you program, such that when you write mole interval, the only things you ever do with X and Y are pass them in as lower bound to upper lower bound or upper bound in order to get their components. And you're expecting these functions to work even if this changes, because whenever you change this, you also change how the data is accessed in the selector. So then you change X bracket zero, close bracket to lower bound X, and you change this to lower bound Y. So seem equivalent, but they're different in that if you were to then later change what interval does, it would still work. Great, okay, so and what if you change all four of these lines so that they never use any square brackets at all, and they just say lower bound and upper bound? What could be wrong then? Well, this is supposed to be returning an interval. The only way to construct an interval is by calling the interval function. So if down here we haven't called the interval function, then we haven't constructed an interval, meaning that whatever this returns wouldn't necessarily have a lower bound, because by making a list, we're assuming some data representation for intervals, which might later not be true anymore. So the trick to fixing that is to call interval here on two arguments, the lower bound and the upper bound, and then I think you're done. Yeah, great question. So, I mean, in general, how do you think about writing functions that process trees? And should you use environment diagrams or, you know, what works well reliably? Here's what works well reliably in my experience is to draw a tree as an example when you're thinking about solving a problem. Make sure it's just large enough that like it exhibits all the interesting properties. So if you write a tiny little tree, sometimes there are no interesting paths in them or whatever. So draw like a slightly larger tree, you know, maybe it has depth 2 or 3, so that you have something to think about as a concrete example when you're trying to solve your problem. And then go ahead and circle the fact that the branches are themselves trees. Think about what would happen if you called the function that you're trying to define on those branches. And so once you figured out, like, oh, I'm trying to define this function, what would happen when I call it on this subtree? Now you know the result of your recursive call. And you can think about, oh, like, now that I have this result of my recursive call, how do I put that together with the root label in order to get the result of the original call? Most tree problems can be solved this way. Not all, but most. So the question was, how come print read has no base case at all? This is a general property of trees that the leaf has no branches. So if you write a function that does something with all the branches, then a leaf will be a base case because it will look up the branches of the leaf, find that there aren't any, and so this whole block of code won't do anything at all. So I could rewrite this as if is leaf, do this. Otherwise, I still want to do this, but then I go through all the branches. Yeah, great question. So the question is, what's the difference between just changing what a name is bound to versus mutating a value or mutation? Why are these really different? And your question about the environment diagram is exactly right. So in an environment diagram, changing what the name A is bound to, it affects stuff that's like in the frame itself. It's about this name. Whereas changing an element in a list doesn't actually change anything about the frame itself. It only changes the object over here on the right. Like this is still pointing to the same thing it was before. Okay. So I have A equals 5. And then I say B equals A. There's actually nothing I can do to B that changes A. I can try as hard as I can to do stuff to B. You know, I can change B to 8. I can call stir on B, call any function I want on B. A will not be changed.
So
why? It's because A was bound to the number 5, and it's impossible to change the number 5. The number 5 always just is what it is. You're right, it's an object, but it's an immutable object. It's one whose properties will be the same no matter what code I write. That's the key to mutation, is that 5 itself can't change. And so if I have two names for 5 and I do stuff with this second name, there's no way I can really affect the first name because it was bound to 5 and I never reassigned A and I never changed 5. And so A is still 5. Life is simple. In the complicated case, where I have C as a mutable value and D equals C. Now there's lots of things I can do to D that will change C as well. Some things wouldn't, like if I go stir D, that doesn't change C. But if I go D append 7, that does change C because C was bound to this list and the list itself isn't changed. It's the same list, but it's got different contents.